प्लीज जरा चेक करें, लाइव फेसबुक पे लाइव आ गया। वेरी गुड जी। वन फाइनल चेक डॉक्टर साहब, मेरी आवाज आ रही है आपको?
जी सर, आ रही है।
थैंक यू। ट्वेंटी फाइव की आज रजिस्ट्रेशन थी तो 158 हो गए हैं। अभी हमारे पास 8 पार्टिसिपेंट्स हैं और अभी लोग आ रहे हैं। अमूमन 15 हो जाए तो हम शुरू कर देते हैं, अनाउंसमेंट्स करने शुरू कर देते हैं। फिर जब तक आपका लेक्चर, मेरी अनाउंसमेंट्स खत्म होंगी और आप लेक्चर शुरू करेंगे तो लोग पूरे हो जाते हैं।
ठीक
आ रहे हैं अभी लोग, तो दो तो 158 है, अभी 2 मिनट है और अभी।
ठीक है,
मैं बार बार, मुझे अनाउंसमेंट करनी पड़ती है कि आप सब लोगों ने अपने कैमरे ऑन रखने हैं। ये आपको पता है, एक पाकिस्तान इंजीनियरिंग काउंसिल की एक अदबन है। आप लोगों ने जो लोग सीपीडी के लिए रजिस्टर्ड हैं उन्होंने अपने कैमरा ऑन रखने हैं। आपकी अपीयरेंस लाइव होनी चाहिए, नजर आनी चाहिए। और ये बीच में प्लीज कैमरा बंद ना कीजिएगा, मुझे बार बार अनाउंसमेंट फिर करनी पड़ती है और स्पीकर डिस्टर्ब होता है और उसका कॉन्सिक्वेंस ये है कि आपका लेक्चर का जो फ्लो है वो नहीं मेंटेन होता। तो काइंडली, मैं अभी अंग्रेजी में जब अनाउंसमेंट करूंगा तो इसको दोबारा रिपीट करूंगा, लेकिन उर्दू में भी आप लोग सुन लें कि ये बड़ा जरूरी है कि आप लोग लाइव, आपकी शक्ल नजर आनी चाहिए। जिसका कैमरा बंद हो जाएगा उसको रिमाइंड कराया जाएगा 3 दफा, चौथी दफा आपको रिमाइंड नहीं कराएंगे। और मैं कहना नहीं चाहता ये बात, फिर क्वेश्चन आपका जो आपको सर्टिफिकेट मिलना है सीपीटी का, उस पर क्वेश्चन मार्क आ जाएगा। तो काइंडली ना हमें उस इम्तिहान में डालें और ना खुद उस इम्तिहान में आए।
भाई साहब
जी जी
अच्छा, मेरा कैमरा जो है ना वो एक साइड के ऊपर है, तो जब मैं इस तरफ को मूव करता हूँ तो मैं कैमरे को फेस करता हूँ, लेकिन मेरी प्रेजेंटेशन इस साइड पे हो रही है।
कोई बात नहीं, कोई बात
कोई इशू तो नहीं है ना?
नो इशू सर, नो
इशू। चलो ठीक ठीक नहीं नहीं ठीक है, ऐसे ऐसा नहीं, ठीक है।
आई बोला है ना, बोलो ना, मीटिंग खाती आज। जी जी सर, अब हम दे थे आज, हम उतना नहीं ना, मैं कैमरे के बैठा, कैमरे के बैठा हम। और हाथी मीटिंग कर, ये कौन बैठा? ये इंजीनियर ने लेक्चर दिन देना।
बारह पार्टिसिपेंट्स हो गए हैं जी हमारे पास। मैं फिर इनफॉर्मली अनाउंस कर रहा हूँ कि काइंडली अपने वेबकैम्स आपने ऑन रखने हैं, आपने लाइव अपीयर होना है स्क्रीन पे। इस काम के लिए खसूसी तौर पे एक खातून मुतय्यन है जो ये मॉनिटर कर रही होती हैं, आपका कैमरा बंद होगा तो आपको फिर रिमाइंडर दिया जाएगा चैट बॉक्स में कि अपना कैमरा ऑन करें, और 3 दफा रिमाइंडर दिया जाएगा, चौथी दफा नहीं दिया जाएगा। तो काइंडली आप लोग लेक्चर की क्वालिटी के लिए, स्पीकर के फ्लो के लिए और लेक्चर के फ्लो के लिए काइंडली हमें बार बार अनाउंसमेंट करने पे मजबूर ना कीजिएगा। कैमरा आपका ऑन होना चाहिए, आपने लाइव अपीयर होना है स्क्रीन के ऊपर। शुक्रिया।
अस्सलाम वालेकुम सर, कमर जैदी सर।
वालेकुम सलाम, मोस्ट वेलकम जैदी साहब, हाउ आर यू सर? लुकिंग सो फ्रेश, एवर ग्रीन, सो हैप्पी टू सी यू।
Actually, I'm in my house, so it's looking fresh. Otherwise, कभी कहीं होता हूँ, कभी कहीं होता हूँ, तो इस वक्त घर पे बैठा हूँ।
अच्छा 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 अच्छा, माशाल्लाह जी, माशाल्लाह।
Thank you sir, बहुत अच्छा आपका ये सिस्टम आपका, और ये बड़ा अच्छा चल रहा है जी। Thank you so much, और बड़े अच्छे टॉपिक्स होते हैं, so nice of you जी।
नहीं जी, thank you very much for your support also जी, you are a regular participant here, so I'm really thankful. और आज तो हमने टॉपिक भी डैम्स का स्ट्रक्चर से आज हमने ब्रेक ली है, डॉक्टर साहब को तकलीफ दी है, he is very experienced in dams, माशाल्लाह। अभी आप इनका इंट्रोडक्शन सुनेंगे तो आपको you will see how notable he is and a scholarly figure. साथियों आप 25 का कह रही थी, 25 है ना रजिस्टर्ड, तो 14 आगे भी 11 रहते हैं, तो 2:04, लेट्स वेट फॉर अदर 2-3 मिनट्स इंशाल्लाह। अरे रियाज अख्तर आपने स्क्रीन शेयर कर दी है, प्लीज अनशेयर कर दें। और रियाज अख्तर को कौन स्क्रीन अपनी अनशेयर करे, इसका क्या किया है रियाज साहब? नहीं नहीं रियाज अख्तर आपने स्क्रीन अपनी शेयर कर दी है, उसको प्लीज अनशेयर कर दें। थैंक यू। Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamu alaikum and a very good afternoon to all participants in the technical lecture number 37 of Pakistan Society of Civil Engineers. Greetings to our viewers on Facebook who are watching this transmission live there. Today's topic is a brief overview of the design concepts for concrete face rock fill dams. And our speaker today is Dr. Zaheer Muhammad Malik. Before I introduce the speaker to you, as usual, I have to spell out the rules of this webinar. The first one is very important, and which is that all the registered participants for CPD points have to appear live on webcam. The exception is only for the ladies. If they wish, they can cover their face. Second is regarding the microphone. During the lecture, all microphones shall remain in mute position except that of the speaker who has to deliver the lecture. Third point is regarding the question answer session. As you know, at the end of the lecture, we have exclusive question answer session for 20 minutes. But the speaker has been kind enough to allow questions to be asked during the lecture, but it has to be by typing the text in the chat box. I will decide when the question has to be asked at what time. That will be sole my prerogative, because I have to keep the flow of the lecture maintained also. During the 20 minute exclusive session for the question answer, you can ask the question by using your microphone. Now, the participants on the Facebook, as you know, there is a time lag of about 30 to 45 seconds on Facebook transmission. But you can ask your questions by typing the text there. Just give us a little time because of the lag which takes place between Zoom and Facebook. Now I come to the introduction of the speaker. Today's speaker, as I've already informed you, is Dr. Zaheer Muhammad Malik. He did his BSc in Civil Engineering in 2001 from Military College of Engineering, Risalpur, National University of Sciences and Technology. His Master's in Hydropower Engineering in 2004 from the Center of Excellence in Water Resources from University of Engineering and Technology, Lahore. He did his PhD in Water Resources Engineering in 2012 from the Center of Excellence in Water Resources Engineering, from University of Engineering and Technology, Lahore. He is serving in a consulting company based in Lahore for the last 15 years. At present, he is a director of projects there. His duties also include design and studies. It must be some research work there. Now his experience. His professional work experience covers different design aspects of preliminary, detailed, and construction levels for hydro level, for hydropower power plants, thermal power plants, irrigation, water supply, and multi-purpose projects. His particular areas of interest involve earth and rock fill dams. In particular, earth core rock fill dams and concrete phase rock fill dams. Dr. Zaheer has been exclusively associated with Satpara Dam project in Skardu, which is 40 meters tall embankment dam founded over glacial moraine deposits on the highest altitudes of Gilgit-Baltistan. He was involved in its design, implementation, and performance evaluation for more than 5 years. Further, he has been involved in the detailed design of Nowlong Dam, Kurumtangi Dam, and Machalgo Dam in Afghanistan. He has also extensive experience of designing the hydropower projects. So far, he has designed a 147 megawatt project Petrant near Muzaffarabad, and he has also designed 106 megawatt Golan Gol hydropower projects. I think most probably Golan Gol is in KPK. He has extensively worked on the feasibility studies of 225 megawatt RLNG based combined cycle power plant in Port Qasim, 400 megawatt Baloki, 200 megawatt Sahiwal thermal power project. It is also a gas-based thermal power plant. Then 125 megawatt Mari Deep, 350 megawatt coal-based thermal power plant in Port Qasim, Karachi. And he has also worked on 200 megawatt Lakra coal plant, coal-fired power plant. Further, his experience is in Bangladesh also for a thermal power plant, which is 225 Bola combined cycle power plant. His affiliations are with Pakistan Engineering Council, Pakistan Geotechnical Engineering Society, Pakistan Engineering Congress, Institute of Engineers of Pakistan, and he's the proud associate of Pakistan Society of Civil Engineers. He has 8 co-publications to his credit. The first one is on reinforced cut slope stabilization in poor rock mass. The second one is suitability of local bentonites for slurry trenching. The third one is investigation and treatment of post-construction incidents at Satpara Dam. And the fourth one is Satpara project on difficult foundations. The fifth one is seepage control for Satpara Dam. It seems Dr. Saab has a very exclusive and detailed experience of Satpara Dam. Then the third one is upgrading capacity at Mangla Dam. The seventh one is hidden troubles of protection dikes. And the eighth one is varied foundation of Chotiari Reservoir. Chotiari, most probably it is in Iran. So this was a very brief introduction of Dr. Zaheer M. Malik. So Dr. Saab, the floor is now yours. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for the very generous introduction. Coming over to the topic, a brief overview of the design concepts for concrete phase rock fill dams. I hope I'm audible, sir. Your voice, I can't hear you, sir. Sir, I can't hear you.
I am saying you are audible and we can hear you, but a little louder voice would be more better.
Right, sir. Thank you. So, concrete face rock fill dams. Concrete face, the CFRD, basically the CF comes from the concrete face and RD is the rock fill dam. So, the name suggests the type of the dam. It basically is a rock fill dam with a concrete face. It belongs to the family of an embankment dams as the cross section is also trapezoidal.
No, sir, your screen is not shared.
Oh, sorry. Sorry.
Yeah. No, it again switched off. You have to share it again. Yeah. Now it is okay.
Is it shared now?
Yes, it is shared.
Okay, sir. Thank you. A brief overview of the design concepts for concrete face rock fill dams. So once again, the concrete face rock fill dam is an embankment dam with a concrete face, and the embankment is made of rock fill. So the CF comes from the concrete face, and the rock fill dam gives it the RD. So CFRD is basically a concrete face rock fill dam belonging to the embankment dam family. Since its cross section is usually a trapezoidal section, and all embankment dams, different types are shown on the screen. Homogeneous, zoned, with impervious face linings, or with an internal cold wall made of artificial material. So the impervious face lining for the concrete face rock fill dam is made out of concrete, basically. The presentation outline would go around the introduction, then specifically some talk on the concrete face. I'll be giving some examples, and then I'll provide some references for further studies or referring to different aspects that we talk about. Coming over to the introduction, basically this concrete face rock fill dam is a variant of the embankment dam, which is more appropriately utilized once you have a rocky foundation, but you have a little bit difficulty in attaining the rocky foundation all along the base of the dam as required for the concrete dams, or you have lack of appropriate core materials. Once you don't have suitable earth fill materials for the core of the zoned embankment, this option of the concrete face rock fill comes in handy. So talking about the economic viability of this dam, this dam is suited to wet climates, which may give short periods in which the earth fill is placed layer by layer. And this results in significant savings in the overall construction schedules. Moreover, the water tightness of the plinth portion of the concrete face is achieved through grouting, which can independently be carried out irrespective of the construction of the dam. So that saves a lot of time because of an independent activity over there. Similarly, the total fill quantities of this embankment, since it's comprised of rock fill only, so it can be reduced to comparatively smaller sections with steeper slopes and comparative savings as compared to the embankment dams. The main features of this dam, as I briefly introduced before, that it is comprised of a concrete face and it is backed by a rock fill to provide it stability. all the water load is basically transmitted upstream of the dam axis. As you can see, the center line of the dam axis lies right at the center of the crest of the dam, the trapezoidal section, and the water load is basically resisted by the concrete face and transmitted right upstream of the dam axis. All of the stability providing this rock fill zone is provided downstream of the water barrier, which is the concrete face. Under normal operating conditions, this rock fill is usually considered to be free draining. So if it's free draining, there are seldom chances of leakages and uplifts within this rock fill zone. And considering that it provides higher strengths against seismic or other differential aspects. And considering that, usually its design is empirical, since most of the times this rock fill is already quite higher strength value, or having quite higher strength value. So considering that, it has the benefit of providing inherent stability for it. Another good option for this is that since the earth fill requires layer by layer placing and smaller thickness of layered material in the layers, so this rock CFRD basically provides a better option even in the diversions. These are some examples for that. It can be managed in stages, in which each stage can be conducted independently. And not only that, the rock fill can be introduced with some protective measures to provide overflow options within the period of construction also. The CFRD basically has its historical origin as early as 1850s, once the rock fill was accepted as high strength and economical dam building material, which was achieved from excavations of spillways or other quarry excavations. Slowly, the experience using the dump rock fill was adopted. And as you can see in this graph shown, the early period was already covering dam heights of around 100 meters using the CFRD type. But there was a period once the higher dams started to demonstrate face damages and leakages due to the dumping, due to the segregation due to the dump rock fill. Then with the advent of vibratory roller compacted rock fill, once it became the standards, this rock fill dam once again came into picture. And then the tall order, as described by the International Water Power and Dam Construction, we had 19, even as early as 1995, we had a 187 meter high CFRD also. We have more than 200 meter dams for comprising this CFRD type. And there are plans in China for more than 300 meter high dams also. The development of CFRD basically was synchronous with the development of construction aspects of the rock fill. The main differences that you can see in the early CFRDs were the dumped rock fill behind the concrete face, whereas a zoned package has been introduced with layers, different layers of rock fill in the modern CFRD concept. Another difference that you can see is the cutoff trench, which was an integral part of the early CFRDs. It is being reported that the origin of this cutoff was basically due to the unknown trends of grouting at that time. And once the grouting came in place, Tarzaghi was the first one who introduced that grouting can be replaced. Grouting can be used as a replacement for excavating the natural foundations of rock and placing the concrete planes right on the rocky foundation and grouting it to provide the required stability of the plinth. The standard typical section of the modern CFRD is presented in this slide. As you can see, there are numbers which are synchronous with the embankment dam terminologies of the gradations, increasing in the order of particle size. 1, 2, and 3 basically are utilized over here. The numeric number 4 is basically reserved for the riprap materials. And since riprap materials support the embankment dams on the upstream side for wave action, in case of a concrete face, that is eliminated. And so we have 1, 2, and 3 as the seepage control, the erosion control, and stability providing zones. The seepage control is basically provided as face slab protection upstream zones, which are basically cohesion lens fine grained soils. And the face slab supporting zones downstream are the actual erosion control components, which are provided beneath the perimeter joints and as face supports, face slab supports. These are fine sand and these are sandy material basically. We'll be talking about them in the next few slides again, once again. Then comes the main dam body zones, which are the rock fin zones. If I go back, we have the zone 1A and 1B. 1A directly in connection with the face slab upstream and the plinth, right on top of it. Then we have it covered for stability and protection against the water loads. With 1B, we have 2A just at the perimeter joint, and we have 2B as the face slab support. 3A provides further transition support to the 2B material and the 3B main rock fill body material. 3B and 3C are basically quarry run rock fill. 3B is relatively smaller in size, and 3C is relatively coarser. Basically, 2A is the filter material, which is minus 36 mm in grade in particle size and laid in 0.4 meters there usually. These are typically standards provided for the design of these dams. So these are basically manufactured materials, 2A and 2B. The remaining rock fills are usually obtained directly from the actual construction excavations. Now, coming over to the concrete face. The concrete face has basically three components: the plinth, its face slab, and the joints. The plinth is the foundation contact of the CFRD, which provides the actual contact with the bedrock. The face slab is the watertight element placed on top of the rock fill zone. It accommodates the deformations which occur during construction and when the water load is applied, and resists passage of that water into the rock fill zone. This face slab and plinth combined has joints. There are vertical joints, horizontal, and parametric connections. We'll be talking about these in the upcoming slides once again. Coming over to the plinth, the basic design aspects which are considered for the plinth comprise of its thickness and its geometry. For the thickness, there's a minimum standard for it. It's usually 0.3 to 0.4 meters. Then at some places, the thickness varies with the reservoir head for higher than 100 meter dams. usually a constant thickness is preferred for construction convenience. Then comes following the plinth thickness comes the plinth width. The plinth width is usually follow. There are different concepts for the plinth width selection, but the most common and most followed standard for the plinth width selection is shown here, which is basically based on the erosion potential of the foundations. So it describes 8 different classes which have to be considered for the specific selection of the plinth width, which go from the foundation type, the foundation class, the width to depth ratio, plinth width to the water depth ratio, then the RQD, and E is the weathering degree of the actual foundation, then the consistency degree, and macro discontinuities per the width and the excavation class. The concrete face plinth basically has different types which can be categorized based on the orientation and the geometry that we'll be discussing later on. Just to have an insight that how this plinth varies, the conventional plinth type is shown over here. It can be combined with an internal plinth concept to reduce the width of the plinth. We have the inclined concept of the plinth also, and at steep slopes, we can utilize this inclined plinth concept to a very effective phenomena. Then there's an articulated plinth concept in which we can have an articulated plinth length, and we won't be removing this articulated plinth concept is most suitable for alluvial deposit scenarios where you have to achieve positive cutoff till the bedrock, which is quite deep. So you use an articulated plinth and you connect the articulated plinth with a diaphragm wall at its upstream end so that you can get the positive connection at the with the bedrock for the seepage control. We've talked about the plinth thickness and the plinth width. This is the typical geometry of the plinth sections. This geometric layout is basically connected with the face slab configuration. As you can see, the face slab rests on the plinth plane, which is defined by the AB line over here. And the face slab reference comes over to the plane of XY. For ease of calculations for the plinth dimensions in the geometric sections, this point Y of the connection of the face slab is usually reproduced directly perpendicularly below into the foundation as the point X1. So basically this X line, which is the face slab reference line, can also be transmitted right at the point of connection at the specific calculated depth behind the face slab and plinth connection, right below to the X1, below the point of connection of point of connection Y. So this gives an easier way to approach the plinth alignment profiles. This is further explained better in the plan view, and basically this typical section is produced two ways, that either it is perpendicular to the plinth plane as shown over here, or it is parallel to the plinth plane as shown in this, normal to the plinth line. The plinth plane is basically the center line of the plinth and face lap connection. So that point, if it is normal to the center line, this is the standard plinth. It has more excavation, but you save the integrity of the design aspects, which are usually used in defining the plinth geometries. And whereas if we save, although we save excavation in aligning the plinth normal to the plinth line, as in this one, but the complexity of defining the overall plinth dimensions increases. Basically, the plinth is laid in a series of straight lines from elevation differences, which suit the foundation and the top alignments of the topography. These points are basically defined by angles in between these elevation differences, the slopes connecting the two different point lines, and there are given formulas to calculate all these aspects. But defining these points is the most critical aspect for CFRD plinth alignment selection. The most common and practical design is to have the plinth. This is the face slab reference line. Let me show you this in this typical depiction of a CFRD upstream face. These are the face slabs, typical face slabs, and this is the connection point, which is the face slab reference line, the in magenta line, in magenta. Basically, this is the most common way of practically defining the geometry of the plinth in plan. The plinth is laid out with horizontal contours, as you can see, along the face slab dimension, which are normal to the plinth. If you see the horizontal plinth, which is basically in the riverbed area, the plinth alignment is perpendicular to the face slab, and the horizontal contours are parallel to the plinth alignment. So considering each and every point over here, if you look at it, the horizontal contours are intersecting the plinth alignment at the perpendicular position. This provides justification of the placement of the plinth on excavated rock conditions, and also the plinth alignment laid normal to the face, normal to the cross section of the plinth. So this is the typical representation of the plinth alignment given in longitudinal profile also. Along the different RDs, this is the riverbed section. And once you reach the rocky area after excavation, we place the plinth on that point, and we connect those points with straight lines so that there are minimum changes in the profile of the plinth alignment. Then comes the face slab. Face slabs are basically defined by their widths, thicknesses, and their joints. And their function is basically water tightness of the overall dam, overall rock fill dam. The face slab thickness is basically selected with dimensions usually constant, but above 100 meters, there are different formulas which are in vogue with a slight increment to the constant usual thicknesses. And those increments are related with the head, water head of the reservoir also. So dams higher than 100 meters usually involve a flaring thickness of the face layer towards the plinth. But usually below 100 meters, we have constant thickness of the face layers. These face layers are basically poured using slip forms, and the usage of these slip forms basically defines their width. So the width of the face layer is basically restricted by the placing capacity of the slip form. The joints in the face layer are basically connections separating different face concrete face elements. Like there are vertical joints which separate adjacent panels of the face layers. There are horizontal joints which differentiate starter slabs from the main face slab, or they are used in separate different, just as in construction of a roof at different ports. And the perimeter joint basically separates the plinth from the face slab. To further understand the purpose and importance of these joints in allowing the concrete face of the concrete face rock fill dam to perform as expected can only be understood once the movements of the or the behavior of the face slab can be understood. The behavior of the concrete face slab under water loads is described in the sectional view. Under water load, the face settles basically inwards onto the rock fill zones. And this is basically the main issue why the dumped rock fill was replaced with layered and compacted rock fill in different zones. So then in the plane of the face layer, there are three different type of movements which basically are concentrated towards the center of the face layer zones. The edges basically move inwards, whereas the concrete face, concrete plinth stays grouted and fixed at its own position. So this displacement at the perimetric joint shows the movement of the face slab with the plinth fixed at its position due to grouting aspects. Considering these movements, basically the central zone of the concrete face comes under compression. Then there's a transition zone, and the edges and the abutments or the abutments with the face slabs come under tension. The direction near the direction of movement near the perimetric joint goes inward, as described in the section in the previous. It goes inward into the rock fill. So this gives more weightage to the selection of the different materials behind the perimetric joints. The specifically the zone 2A, which is directly beneath the perimetric joint. Then the face slab deflections are controlled by 2B material. All these two, the material zone 2, which is the downstream protection zone for the face concrete face, these materials are further supported by the zone 3A, which rests on 3B and 3C. If we come back to this slide, the zones 2B and 2A, the position of zone 2A and 2B as processed material, the usage of these materials beneath these joints is therefore required. And these zones are supported by the rock fill zone, main body rock fill zones. considering the compression, considering these tension and compression elements behavior of the face slab, we divide the vertical joints of the face slab into compression joints and tension joints. Compression joints are usually the inner slab joints, and tension joints are usually the abutment connections. Since concrete is good in compression, the central portion is heavily concreted, whereas the tension element is improvised within these joints to allow the face slabs to take that tension using water stops and measures of different materials. Like in the outer slabs, if there's a tension joint, we usually there's a three-layered arrangement for the joints setting. There's a copper water stop at the base, which is usually a standard, a metal water stop basically. Then there's a PVC water stop in the center, and there's a mastic joint filler placed on top of this joint to allow further tensions. Whereas these central two flexible type of water stops are not used in the compression joints for the inner slabs. These are typical representations with a typical thickness of 0.3, a constant thickness of 0.3 for the face slab. The horizontal construction joints are used for the starter slabs or when a portion of the slab panel is not poured in continuity due to an unscheduled interruption. So the procedure is similar to the green cut joints at as used on the pouring of roof slabs. Coming over to the parametric joint, the parameter joint movements with the plinth affixed with the foundation are either rising or settling into the with respect to the rock fill body. And due to that, there is an opening or closing of the joints at the perimeters. So the concept of three-layered water stops as for the abutments to take the tensions in the tangential directions are improvised within the those perimeter joints also. There are two locations of the perimeter joints. One is at the connection of the plinth with the face slab, and the other is at the crest, where usually a parapet wall is improvised and the face slab connects with the parapet wall. So the same copper water stop, PVC water stop, and mastic joint filler considerations are given to this perimeter joint also with a mortar pad backup. Coming over to some examples for this, these are the geometric alignments of the plinth for different dams. And as these dams are high dams, quite high dams. And as you can see, there are linear segments all along the face slab corners, which define the plinth alignments. These are two typical dams, two dams from literature taken up. And you can see the concept of compression and tension joints as per the standard detail. These are the compression joints, and these are the abutment tension joints. Whereas this one is the connection joint at the perimeter, which is defined by the connection of the face slab with the plinth. This is the perimeter joint, which is coming all along the connection of the face slab with the parapet wall. Similar concept of the tension joint is also available over here in this dam. And this is the detail of the water stop. There's the copper water stop, and there's a Bostick filler over here. These are two dams, which we'll be describing in further details, covering the plinth alignments as shown, arranged in with the horizontal contours normal to the plinth alignments. Similarly, over here, the horizontal contours are normal to the plinth alignments. And there are elevation points picked up with reference to the required cutting underneath the face layer, so that the plinth can be placed directly on rock in linear segments. So this is the typical layout of the first example. We have a slope of one vertical to 1.5 horizontal, which is quite steep as compared to the normal embankment dams with the zone or homogeneous sections. We have a control joint, which is a horizontal joint, and we have multiple horizontal joints at these starter slabs, which are not rectangular in shape, and usually these are not these are formed. These are not usually placed with the slip form arrangement. So the connection points of these starter slabs with the normal face slabs are provided with a horizontal joint. And these are defined as the outer slabs. These abutment slabs are defined as the outer slabs, which are to be provided with vertical tension joints, whereas the inner slabs lying in the riverbed reach are designated as inner slabs, which shall be provided with vertical compression joints. This is the provided arrangement as per the standard typical sections that were described before. With the tension joints are provided with three layer of water stops, whereas the compression joint eliminates the requirement of the central bulb type water stop and the top mastic fillers. This is the arrangement at the parapet wall. And this is the arrangement at the connection perimeter of the face slab with the plinth. This is the typical arrangement of the backfill zones, which are according to the standard 1, 2, 3 zone numbers. As you can see, beneath the plinth, there's protective filter 2A, which provides self-healing in case of failure of this water stop, and which the face slab is protected over 2B, which is supported by 3A, and the main rock fill body is provided through 3B and 3C. This is a refinement concept which was used in the planning and design of this dam. Initially, there were quite a number of points utilized based on the topo and the horizontal contours in connection with the perpendicular to the plinth alignment. But with due consideration, three points along the plinth alignment was along plinth alignment defined by the face slab reference line were reduced and in favor of a more smoother and more simpler arrangement for the plinth alignment. As you can see, the difference in the excavation is not quite much, but the profile and the plan is more simplified for execution purposes. This is the simple use of the calculation formulas for the point definement and the geometric alignment of the plinth in plan and in its section along the face slab reference lines. This portion over here was basically improvised to provide access to a conduit. There was a conduit passing through the dam, and there a conduit can be passed through either through the face slab or underneath the plinth alignment. These are 3D projections just to provide an overview of how these conduits can be passed through the main dam alignments. This is the conduit passing through the face slab. In this case, we have more critical aspects to be considered for the joints along the conduit, which penetrate through the face slab projections. On the other hand, these critical concerns are eliminated once the conduit is placed below the plinth line. The conduit can be passed through the plinth, underneath the plinth, in two ways. Either we have an inclined plinth. In that case, we have to get more concrete, more excavation and more backfilling of concrete till the plinth. This can also be economized if the horizontal plinth over conduit concept is used, which has been used in this this arrangement. So it economizes the quantity of excavation and also the concrete backfill. Each individual component of the plinth alignment has a different variation based on these values, which are computed for due to its origin and placement in the, both in the plan and the section. So considering this typical plinth section, the point reference lines between these two elevations is converted using those parameters into such a shape. This same plinth geometry is transformed into this shape only because of the influence of the elevations of the which are available at the plinth alignment. Similarly, you can see this this specific typical section varying in between each elevation difference. These two points are basically those variations which are near to the riverbed area. If we consider this point 3, point 4, 5, and 6, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. We come back over here. This is point 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. Since these are near the riverbed area, which is where the face slabs are perpendicular to the plinth alignment, that replicates the typical section geometry over here. You can see the amount of excavation required to lay down the plinth alignment as defined with the face slab reference line. These are the different amount of excavations. The plinth slab is basically used for as a grouting pad also. So we have it anchored into the foundation. We have it, we have sleeves inserted within the plinth slab concrete to be used for grouting consolidation grout holes and curtain grout holes. The curtain grouts can be single line or double line, but usually within the center of the pad, whereas the consolidation grout holes are placed upstream and downstream of the curtain grout holes. These are variations of the grouting arrangements placed along the different elevation points and the different plinth configurations as per the profile. Like in between points P1 and P2, which are quite near the crest level, there is a single line grout curtain which deviates into a double line grout curtain as the water head is increased towards the progress towards the riverbed area. And the consolidation grout holes are completed upstream and downstream of the curtain grout holes. The anchor bars and the position of the grout sleeves are shown over here. This is another arrangement where the articulated plinth concept has been utilized. The points defined in the plan and the longitudinal alignment are shown over here. The riverbed reach over here had informed the investigations before planning for this type of dam indicated that the depths of bedrock were quite deep at the riverbed plinth area. So for that, the cutoff depth, the diaphragm cutoff was also introduced in this. And that diaphragm cutoff was provided in connection with the plinth as this. So since the practical depth of the cutoff is limited to around 50 meters, a maximum of 50 meters, the balance amount had to be excavated to found the plinth on ground and connected with the cutoff at the upstream end, similar to this one. So you can see the level of excavation required to achieve this depth, and then the articulated concept with the concrete cap and the concrete cutoff wall according to the depth required. This project was located in a zone where glaciers are also developed, and so the concept of GLOF had to be, the glacial lake outburst flood had to be considered over here also. So the type of dam is also suitable for that, as I'll be explaining in the next stages. There's a concept of zone 1A and 1B on top of the face slab and plinth zones, which serve as protection barriers also. This is a short video. So this is an image taken before the phenomena of GLOF at the site. So if you can see the morphology and the meanders of the river with change, and also this zone, which is influenced by the breach of this glacier lake. So I'll be zooming up to this area now. These yellow circles would provide a little bit more facility in depicting the changes that are developed after, before and after the block impacts. If you can notice the red arrows over here, the alignment of the bridge has changed now. After the gloss period, this bridge had to be relocated at the top left corner shown. And if the bed load you can see over here, just at the right side, there are boulders which travel with the gloss phenomena from this side and right up to the area where the dam has to be placed. So the actual concept which was improvised for this was a CFRD dam, two boulder traps, then the reservoir itself, then the coffer dams which were not removed, and ahead of it, the zone 1B and 1A on top of the face slab and the plinth. So in case of any eventuality, this is going to be the first line of defense against any ingress of boulders, which could come and damage the main dam body. Once the upstream of these boulders, boulder traps are filled up with the ingress of boulders, these boulder traps are designed such that they can be further heightened towards the downstream side. The next, even if in the eventuality that the boulders overflow these boulder traps, the reservoir itself would provide a stilling pond for the boulders. And the presence of this, the coffer dam, which is used during construction for this overall main dam, since it is not removed, it would be placed in position and it would provide another line of barrier for the boulder, for the ingress of boulders. And considering the eventuality that even if the boulders which come overtop this coffer dam also, we have the concrete face and the plinth protected with zone 1A and 1B. The anything which overtops the coffer dam also would be coming directly in contact with a random fill of zone 1B. So considering this CFRD concept in a Glof region, you can see there are you can see the three lines of the normal lines of defense for any dam would prove more reliable and safe considering the CFRD concrete face rock building. Moreover, since this project is in a Glof zone also and it is a high seismic zone also, so the utility of a concrete face rock fill dam with its joints and its flexibility in the concrete face with back with the rock fill zone provides more safer dam type to be improvised within this zone. We've reached the end of the presentation and we have some references now. So if there are any questions, sir, I've reached the end of nearly the end of the presentation, sir.
So, if there are any questions, kindly type them in the text box, or you can ask the questions using your microphone. So we have 20 minutes question answer session, which has already started. And if there are any questions, please type them or ask them in the microphone.
So mostly the matters for this presentation and the latest trends of designing and constructing CFRDs are provided in these two references. One is the Geotechnical Engineering of Dam, second edition, fell from the CRC Press, Balkema. And the other mostly utilized is the Bulletin 141 of I-Code regarding concrete face rockfill dams, concept for design and construction. Anybody who is interested in further reads, I've listed a few historical benchmarks in the development of this specific type of dam also. There was a special memorial issue of the Journal of Geotechnical Engineering, volume 113. And it was specifically introduced by Sherrard and Cook, who were both the originators and flag bearers of this concept of embankment dam. Then there's a Barry Cook volume, famous because of the introduction part of dedicated to the to Barry Cook basically himself. And then there's a book published by Taylor and Francis on concrete face rockfill dams, which is also a good read regarding the specific aspects for this dam.
Dr. Saab, Kamar Ali Zaidi, Mr. Zaidi is asking, when the dam is empty, is there any possibility of negative stresses on the face slab? And if so, how it is taken care of?
Sure, sir. The condition of emptiness of the dam comes in its phase of life twice. Once is during the construction, before the first impounding. And second is basically if in the eventuality, in an eventuality, the dam has to be dewatered. So under those two phenomena, basically the first phenomena, once the rock fill behind the face slab is not saturated, because it's rock fill and it is just constructed, it has not come in contact with the water, and the face slab joints are in place intact. So in that case, the face slab stresses, specifically the negative stresses, which would be concentrated towards the central zone, which is going to be the compression zone, are not going to be that preferential, because that has not already gone through the water cycle. The critical case would be once the dam has been impounded, and after impounding, there has been an eventuality once you have to draw down to a level to expose these face slabs. So in that case, the most critical aspect would be once any specific vertical or horizontal joint or the perimeter joint has failed within a local portion on the face of the dam. And due to that, the backfill, the rock fill supporting the overall embankment water barrier, the concrete face has come in contact with water. So the first of all, the impacts, the implications would be cracking of the face lab, lifting of the face lab, or similar situations. So in that case, I've not discussed the orientation of the reinforcements, which are basically introduced within these face slabs near the joints to cater for different phenomena of concrete stress aspects. But still, the compression, the central compression zones, not only those are affected, because of the stresses on the compression zones, the tension zones are also pulled up. So that is usually incorporated with the portions of the concrete itself and the reinforcement, both. The first and foremost thing is that historically, this concept of the negative stresses was realized in dumped rock fill scenarios, once there were no zones behind the concrete face to take up the eventuality of leakages and safely discharge them without degrading the segregation into sloughing and settlements. So once the concept of zoned arrangements has been introduced and there's a layer, a filter layer directly in place with the contact of the face slab, that plus the reinforcement considerations both take up the phenomena of stresses under these unforeseen phenomena.
Okay. The next question is from Uzair Akram. Mr. Akram is asking, what are the stress conditions at the toe and heel of the dam when it is empty?
I suppose the previous question, conditions, it addresses partly the conditions once the dam is empty. The specific stresses at the heel and toe of the dam. I'll come back to this slide where I showed the behavior along the perimeter joints. This is the specific origination of stresses, how because of the positioning and the movement due to water load in the perimeter joint and the at the toe. At the heel, since a section of the dam shows larger rock fills, either in the older concept or in the modern concept, both have larger rock fill towards the heel of the dam, and larger rock fill aspects, since the particle size is larger, so it has more strength to not only that, the inherent capability of this rock fill zone provides it more permeable region, the free draining concept also. So considering that, the stress is more to be concentrated and considered critical are at the toe, not the heel. I hope this covers the second question also.
Yeah. Now the third question is from Suhail Raza. Mr. Raza is asking, since the concrete face slab is submerged under water, what is the mechanism of inspection for any damages or failures? And second, are any electronic sensors placed permanently to monitor the strains, giving alarm for any dangerous changes in the concrete face slab?
Right, sir. the first question has partly been answered in the second question also, because I have not touched the instrumentation of the CFRD aspect. The CFRD, each joint has each joint is monitored through specifically installed instruments, which are read at the crest or at an instrument house, which is safely out of the submerged zone. So basically, as per the standard instrumentations of concrete dams or for the embankment dams, there are strain meters, pressure cells, there are joint meters, there are which are installed within the concrete face joints, slabs, both, or the perimeters, perimetric joints also. Moreover, they provide the initial intimation of any ingress of damage or failure. And of course, as with any other dam, if any damage or failure has already been done, so there is no other mechanism except to dewater the dam or the reservoir and go and rectify the damage, observe it, and go through the observational phase and use the actual parameters at that time to convert in, an intervention, to convert the to place an intervention so that the damage can be rectified. But before that damage or the failure, there are instruments placed within the face slab, as I mentioned earlier, the pressure cells, the inclinometers can also be used, the strain meters, the joint meters, in the concrete portion, the concrete face, and piezometers or extensometers within the filter zone 2B or 3A, which provide information of excessive leakages or any such sort of phenomena, which may give an indirect indication that something is going on wrong, or there is some area which has to be inspected just after this first imponding.
Next question is from Kamar Ali Zaidi. Mr. Zaidi is asking, should not we provide nominal reinforcements in entire length of the face slab?
Usually it is the nominal reinforcements which are provided, but the arrangement of these reinforcements is the main concept for this face slab, for the difference in the compression and tension joints. Basically, there are two schools of thoughts, and there are many other aspects which go into the arrangement of these reinforcements. Like, just as the roof slabs, roof slab corners, basically, they are more protected with reinforcement of a diagonal or to cover the edges, basically. So the similar concept is within the face slabs also. The edges are more protected, and sometimes in the tension or compression zones, the arrangement of the reinforcements is differentiated. The nominal reinforcements usually for other structures are not specified, but for this one, usually for other other structures, the nominal reinforcements are temperature and steel temperature reinforcements. But for this, usually 0.3% or there's a percentage specified for the amount of reinforcement to be introduced within the face slab according to its thickness.
Well, we have now, I can't see any questions written in the chat box. Still, if anybody wants to ask a question using his microphone, he's most welcome. We have 4 or 5 minutes left in the question answer session. If somebody is interested, he can write. Sohail Raza is asking the question. Mr. Raza is asking, is there any CFRD in progress in Pakistan?
In progress, yes. Constructed, also yes. In progress, the Moment Dam is basically a CFRD dam. Constructed, we have Palai Dam in KPK. We have Batusar Toisar Dam in Balochistan. We also have the Mirani Dam, the historical Mirani Dam, basically in Balochistan also. So that was basically the first CFRD in Pakistan.
So now, just looking at the chat box, if I have missed any questions there. No, we don't have any questions. Let me check on the Facebook also. Any question on Facebook? Do we have any questions on the Facebook, Sasha? So it looks like we have now ended the session of question answer also. So now the Q&A session is also over, and I will thank you very much, Dr. Zaheer M. Malik, for such a knowledgeable lecture.
Thank you, sir.
Which covered the basics and which covered the details also. So thank you very much. I hope the audience have enjoyed the lecture and have and the knowledge which you have given would be beneficial for them in their practical life. So thank you very much again. Now I will make some announcements regarding Dr. Saab. Your shield and your certificate, inshallah, would be delivered on the address we have given. Most probably it is your office address. It will be delivered there in the coming week. And the participants, you can collect your CPD lectures. CPD certificates from 15th of December, which is Wednesday, from 83M Model Town Extension, Lahore. And the phone number is, if you want to contact the office before coming there to collect your certificates, the phone number is 0345-424-3404. I repeat, 0345-424-3404. I repeat the address again, 83M Model Town Extension, Lahore. Now, with this, we come to the end of this lecture. And with the conclusion of today's lecture, we have completed the series of lectures scheduled for this year, that is 2021. We hope the lectures which have been provided has imparted and spread knowledge which has been beneficial for those who joined us in our lectures. Inshallah, next year we will continue with our lectures with more zeal and try to bring as far as possible knowledgeable speakers to deliver the lectures. The schedule of lectures for the next year is not ready at the moment, so I can't give you the topic and the speaker of the first lecture in the next year, that is in January, but I can give you the date. The date of the next lecture is 15th January 2022. And, same time, 2 p.m., the topic and the speaker, the name of the speaker will be announced, but I think by the end of this month. I am pretty sure that either earlier or maximum by the end of this month. So, kindly wait for that time till the list of the lectures is finalized. So thank you very much and for attending this lecture and supporting Pakistan Society of Civil Engineers. Thank you very, very much, and Allah bless you all.